the many who are kind of getting oriented to a little different schedule than we've had, and a number of people who've been taking advantage of our five adult class offerings at 9:45 and our multiple opportunities for students, children, 9:45 and 10:45. We just encourage you to find a place to connect, to belong, to grow, and to live an inspired life that we might call a God-filled life. We're blessed that you're here this morning, and we'd like to encourage you and invite you kindly to use the friendship pads that are nearby. It really does help us be alert to the number of folk who are in our midst, some maybe here for the very first time. And if you've joined us online, we want to welcome you. We know that any time when we gather, we have a number of folk who stream the services from really all around the country and sometimes from other countries when people are away on vacation or perhaps business. We're blessed to know that you're there. We have just two things we want to highlight this morning. As a part of our family ministry, our family and marriage ministry, there's an upcoming date night opportunity on the 29th. There's more information, give you more detail about that. You can either go to the website or you can read in the bulletin, inviting couples to grow in their sense of belonging together. We also want to encourage you to step back, and really, you'd be surprised, this can apply to all ages, quite literally, an invite from our media team ministry.
This is my dad. He needs help with media, sound, and lights. All you need is just one finger. All this stuff looks pretty scary, doesn't it? But here's the secret. All the hard things have already been done, making work on Sunday really very easy. It just takes one finger and bam! It's so easy, even an adult could do it.
As we have gathered together for worship, please join me in the call to worship. Lord, help me as I try to do my best for you. Remind me that it is what you see in me that matters most. Show your light through my life. We can never be beyond the borders of God's forgiveness and grace. There's no life or location where God's forgiveness cannot reach us. So with that in mind, let us pray together the prayer of confession this morning. Almighty God, in raising Jesus from the grave, you shattered the power of sin and death. And we confess that we remain captive to doubt and fear, bound by the ways that lead to death. We overlook the poor and the hungry, and pass by those who mourn. We are deaf to the cries of the oppressed, and indifferent to calls for peace. We despise the weak, and abuse the earth you made. Forgive us, God of mercy. Help us to trust your power. Change our lives. Make us new, that we may know the joy of life abundant, given in Jesus Christ, the risen Lord. Amen. Let us continue our confession in silence. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in the position to condemn?
Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life is gone, and the new life has begun.
Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen.
seated. Our scripture reading this morning comes to us from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. Hear God's word as I share it with you. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come. So many gathered that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus and, after digging through it, lowered the mat the paralyzed man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, some teachers of the law were sitting there thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately, Jesus knew in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts. And he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the man, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this." The word of the Lord.
Our lives long, our lives. any kids here that would like to join me up front, I would love to hang out with you. Hi, come on up. All right. You two are going to have a lot of work to do. Oh, we have some more. Oh, look at this. We have many friends. All right. All right, guys. It's the three of you men. All right, I need you to come and take a corner of this thing. Come take a corner. Okay. I'll take this side. All right. Tim, I need you to come lay on this, and we're going to carry you down to Bethesda North. You guys think we can do it? Really? Good job. All right. All right. No. Okay. That would have been really hard, don't you think? Do you know where Bethesda North is? It's like a couple miles that way. Do you think we could have carried him all the way there if he was sick? I don't think so. I don't know if we would have made it out of this room. Like, it would take a lot of work. And then once you get there, what if the hospital was closed? We would have to, like, climb up to the roof and try to find a way to dig through the concrete and then lower him down into the hospital. Do you think you would be up for that? I wouldn't. I'm going to tell you right now, I wouldn't. I would just leave him here. That's what I would do. No offense. Oh, Emery laughed at that, too. Well, our story today was that these friends had a friend who was really sick, and they did that. They carried him on a blanket, and they carried him all the way to Jesus because they knew Jesus would be able to heal him. And so they took all that effort to carry their friend all the way to Jesus. And even when they got there, they couldn't get in, and so they climbed up on the roof, and they dug a hole, and they dropped him down just so Jesus could see them. These men had great faith that Jesus was a healer, and they went through all that effort. Well, you know what? There's going to be obstacles in our life to tell other people about Jesus. We're going to hit obstacles all the time. Maybe we'll be scared. Maybe we just won't want to. Maybe we will feel like the time isn't right. But Jesus is worth it. To get through those obstacles, to carry people there, we have to. I see I've captivated you guys this morning with this. I'm so glad. I have a mission for you this week, all right? All right, you ready for your mission? Even if you're scared, I want you to tell one person that Jesus loves them that doesn't know it yet. Do you think you can do it? You think you're up for the challenge? You think you're up for the challenge? It might be hard. I think you can do it. And learn to talk this week and do it at the same time. Will you pray with me? Gracious Father, please be with us this week and every day as we try to share the message of the gospel with others. We know it's hard, and we know there'll be obstacles in front of us, but if you fill us up, we know we can do it. And all God's children said, amen. You guys can head back to your seats. Thanks for coming up with us. Hi.
Friends, will you please pray with me? Holy Lord, we ask for the grace and strength to rise in such a way that our energy and effort might always point to you and bring you glory. For we ask it in Christ's loving name. Amen. Some of them might have thought Jesus was crazy. Crazy to be involved in caring enough about human life to forgive the burden and baggage of sin. Crazy in his commitment. A desire to demonstrate the authority that he has to forgive sin by saying to one who's paralyzed, "Get up! Go home, take your mat," and the crowd is left in awe, paralyzed, this person is brought to Jesus is paralyzed. Friends go to superhuman efforts to bring him into the healing strength and energy of Christ. Truth be known, each one of us here can experience being paralyzed in a whole variety of ways. We often one-dimensionalize it. Some of us have known what it's like to be paralyzed by fear and to be left immobile by worry. We may be in gridlock because of our unwillingness to really trust our life and its circumstances to the sufficiency of God's saving care, because we want to be in control. And I don't think anything has changed in the human condition in that regard. We want to be in control, and often we're paralyzed by uncertainty when we can't be. We catastrophize, we create all these worst-case scenarios, and the thing is, we're good at it. And a paralyzed man is brought to Jesus, and he walks home. Last week, we began a series that we are calling More Than a Carpenter, because Jesus is and will eternally be more than a carpenter. But a carpenter he is. He works with the real stuff of life. There's a fresh vigor in his earthiness and his ability to sanctify human lives and make experiences that are common divine, because they become God-filled as they become hope-filled with the depth of his care. Often we one-dimensionalize Jesus. We may keep him locked away in stained glass where we can only approach him from a distance. And we make him only to be austere and reverential. And it makes us afraid, so there's no intimacy of connection or relationship. On the other side, we may refer to Jesus as being our best bro, our best brother, one that we would love an opportunity to have a few beers with and pour out our life story, believing that in his company we would receive careful and respectful handling. Well, both of those are incomplete pictures, because Jesus is more than a carpenter. He's the Son of God. He's the Son of Man. He's the Son of David. He's the Son of Mary. He's the suffering servant. He's the high priest. He's the Prince of Peace. He's the chief cornerstone. He's the captain of our souls. He's the Alpha and the Omega. He's the bright morning star. He's the Messiah. He's the Savior. Last week, as a beginning point of getting a little better acquainted with this Jesus, we talked about the power of his name, and we called it a name that bothers people. The name of Jesus often does, because it has a defining and dividing quality about it. There's an accountability when you are near the name of Jesus, because by that name he seeks to draw us fully in to God's life, and for some of us, that's not where we want to be because we don't want to give up control. We want to call some of the shots. It was interesting to see the story of Peter and John, who were hauled before the Sanhedrin and the elders because they were guilty. They were guilty of teaching and preaching and healing in the name of Jesus. And so the religious leaders were wrestling with what the best punishment might be. All the while, the person that was healed and restored, who was somewhere in his 40s, was right there. So, like, there's no denying what just took place. And you're having a problem with it? Really? So, their punishment is that Peter and John would no longer teach, preach, or heal in the name of Jesus. Because they were afraid this Christian movement was going to get out of control. And they were doing their best to shut it down. You cannot shut down what God is doing. And so they respond quite sincerely but forcefully, saying, you know, we're going to pay attention to God rather than you. That's really where the life is. So often we step back out of fear, out of what we do not understand. And there were many who did not understand Jesus, and they tried to marginalize him. Some thought he was a kook. And some were just so laden with their doubts that they wanted to get as far away from it as possible. Because what Jesus represents is a wholly new life, a wholly new way of being, where we find fulfillment in turning over our life. Where we find our lives elevated by willingly assuming the role of a servant. The world doesn't always understand that conversation, but it's the gospel story. And today we step into another dimension of Jesus' life and work, asking, is he who he says he is, or is he crazy? Notice, there isn't a whole lot of middle ground there. You're not picking from an a la carte menu when it comes to having a relationship with Jesus. I think that's pretty good. We want selectively to be touched, blessed, and engaged by Christ rather than affirming God is really the actor, the driver, and we have to trust how God wants to transform the story of our life. It's not our doing to say, well, Lord, we'd like to shade it a little bit here. We'd like a little more of this stuff, a little less of that. It's a God-driven thing. We have sometimes pasteurized what Jesus has said. And we hear some of his words that are rather radical. And we say, well, that's nice. That brings me comfort. I feel lifted by that. We sometimes hear it with a kind of dull sameness that doesn't move or stir our hearts. But let me tell you, you would be concerned about my well-being if on a given Sunday I was to come out and stand and without any preface to tell you that I was quoting someone else, if I was to stand here and say, friends, I am the light of the world. I am the way, the truth, and the life. I am the good shepherd. I am the true vine. I am the bread of life. I am the gate. you might encourage the personnel committee to prompt me to make sure a sabbatical is in my planning for the next day. Say, what is going on? Is he okay? You cannot make statements like that and not recognize that it calls the hearer to say, I'm in or I'm out. Jesus doesn't say, I am one of the many lights of the world. He doesn't say, there's lots of good bread to eat and you could try my variety and you'll like it. He's saying something essential and defining about life in relationship to him and the God we will come to know. And when he uses that language, and that's only a small portion of some of the language Jesus uses to describe and define himself, he is directly going back to the witness of the Old Testament in the book of Exodus. When Moses said to God, you want me to go to Pharaoh? Who am I supposed to say has sent me? And God says, say, I am has sent me to you. And when Jesus picks up that mantle of saying, I am, he is telling us something very real and clear about who he is and the God he is. And it's also a Lord with a very common touch. You know, before I came here, I served a congregation in Michigan for 20 years. It was a big church. At its apex, it had about 4,000 members. In fact, it was the largest church in our synod, which links us in a couple of states. There were five pastors. I never dreamed that I would keep ascending and end up at one time being their acting head. But of course, in Presbyterian parlance, we promote from the outside so you could do the job, you couldn't have the job. Which puts you in a very awkward situation when a new person is called. Which was one of the things that helped lead us here to Cincinnati. And that was a good thing. One of the legends who had served that church for 30 years, a man named David, had a reputation of showing up about 10 seconds before a funeral service would happen. That was just his style. And he was all over the place. And in that environment, more funeral services happened in funeral homes than in churches. And I think that's a reflection of the then General Motors influence, where really General Motors was the God who took care of you, providing for a whole host of financial needs. So it's not surprising that more funerals would be in funeral homes than in churches. On this given day, David had arrived about 10 seconds before the service, and there were several chapels within the funeral home. He believed he knew the one where he was to be. And according to the good stuff of my sources, he arrived and didn't even sit down, went right out in front, extended his arms and said, I am the resurrection and the life. Someone seated in the front row said, well, you may be, buddy, but the funeral you're doing is down the hall. And yet Jesus comes to us as the one who is resurrection. He is the one who restores life, who renews life, who lifts life, who saves life. His death and resurrection proves to us that there's nothing that God cannot handle when we are willing to give that Lord of life ultimate maneuvering room and authority in our lives. And he has a continual stream of things that he shares with the disciples and with others that sometimes pass us by about who he is, about what he's doing, about the full scope of the story of salvation for humanity. And here's a quote from John's Gospel in the 5th chapter, something that we could easily overlook. He says this, he says, "You diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me, yet you refuse to come to me to have life." That relationship is a direct connect. It is not about being helped or ultimately captured by the piety of a loved one, an ancestor, a family member. It is about having that relationship directly yourself so that you can be touched by the movement of Christ in your midst. Before church councils existed, making a variety of decrees and creeds, it was very clear that in the life of the early church, not that far removed from Jesus at all, the clear track was one of saying Jesus is divine, Jesus is God. And sometimes we are helped when we hear voices beyond the voice of Scripture speaking to that. Here's Ignatius of Loyola from around 110. He said, "God incarnate, God himself appearing in the form of man." That is who Jesus is and will eternally be. Another brave servant of the church called Justin Martyr used these words, "Being the first begotten word of God is even God." They're not seeing any wiggle room here. They're saying God in human form visited us in planet Earth in the person of Jesus. And then lastly, Irenaeus from the early church put it this way. And once again, this is before church councils had met. "The Father is God and the Son is God, for he who is born of God is God." Now leave it to C.S. Lewis to put a wonderful twist on this, to really call us into accountability about the nature of the relationship with Jesus. And once again, it's not an a la carte menu. He serves us every course and invites us to sit down, to partake, and to receive the fullness of his Spirit in us. You can shut him up for a fool, you can spit at him and kill him as a demon, or you can fall at his feet and call him Lord and God. But let us not come up with any patronizing nonsense about his being a great human teacher. He has not left that open to us. He did not intend to. This Jesus brings us the whole meal, the fullness of life with God. And with utter confidence and reverence and gratitude, we can say, "Thank you, Lord, for being crazy, even crazy about me." May we walk with him ever in the confidence of his care and be blessed. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
May we remain standing as we affirm our faith together through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. As we come to our time of prayer, we do have a significant prayer ministry here at Sycamore. We have prayer partners who are more than willing to pray with you if you would like to continue your prayer following the worship service. Remain in your seats or come forward, and they would be delighted to pray with you. The flowers in the sanctuary today were given by Chuck and Ann Beavis in celebrating their, wait for it, 66th wedding anniversary. And so that's it. And they are both still smiling. That's a good thing. Let us go to God in prayer. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for today, not only for the beautiful day, but this gathering together, an opportunity to step outside of our routine, to come to you, to give you alone the worship and praise you deserve, and to be refueled for the coming week. We come to you with joys, with concerns. We come to you with thankful hearts. And we share in this time of worship, we also share in fellowship, which likewise encourages us. We thank you that you are using this, our family of faith, this congregation, to inspire, to connect with one another, to grow your spirit. We pray that you would continue your good work in and through this congregation, and we are thankful for all those who work so hard in so many different ways. From providing coffee for the service, refreshments, singing in the choir, teaching Sunday school, serving on the session and deacons, trustees. If we were to name them all, we would be here for quite some time. We're thankful for those who serve so diligently and so well, and pray that you would continue to use them, to continue to inspire, to connect, to grow, to serve. We may know of some individuals, perhaps some who are connected to us here, who have weathered a hurricane, and we pray that you would continue to keep them safe. We pray that you would be with them in the months of recovery that will follow. Be their provision, their safety. Fill them with your hope and encouragement. In the same way, we may know those who are ill at home, could not be with us, or who are recovering from surgery or illness, those who are homebound for several reasons, and hear us as we silently and individually pray for those. And as we move forward into our week, as your redeemed people, we need your wisdom and grace for what we will be experiencing and seeing. We know only today you hold each day and our futures in your hand. There may be a particular decision we have to make. There may be things where we work that we have to deal with. And And so we pray for your wisdom and grace that in these situations we may shine as your light. And hear us as together in silence we lift these specific concerns in our lives for this coming week. Heavenly Father, we understand that nothing we have is ours, but has been graciously and overwhelmingly provided to us by your grace. May we never forget who you are. May we never forget who we are to you. And in that way, hear us as we pray the prayer that your Son and our Savior has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let us continue our worship together by presenting to God our tithes and our offerings.
Friends, we just want to take a moment and to thank Holly Roberts and the membership committee for leading us in a new member class yesterday. With our new schedule, people have a variety of opportunities to connect. So we publicly recognize some at 8:45. We had a reception at 9:45. But I believe at this service, Rich Kern is here. Rich, will you just stand? Rich is a friend of this church family, and he has rejoined after being gone for a few years. And he's back as a friend in Christ. And he's one of the group which included Kelly Benitez, Braulio Benitez, Juliana Lynn, Tom Wilkinson, and Rich. Bless you, friend. We're glad you're here, brother. Thank you. Friends, to the glory of God, I encourage you to do this and do this gladly. Go with joy. Live in faith. Believe that life is good. And if you find it not, help make it so. To the glory of God who made us. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship, friendship, and power of the Holy Spirit lead us forward together each step of the way. Amen.